isolation to bring him to the point of relinquishing material goals, of renouncing a nationality that has a tendency to be somewhat parasitic within the boundaries of other nations, and to express inclusive love instead of separative unhappiness. And what of the Gentile attitude? It is absolutely necessary that the nations meet the Jew more than halfway when he arrives at altering, slowly and gradually, his nationalistic orthodoxy. It is essential that they cease from fear and persecution, from hatred and from placing barriers to cooperation. The growing anti-Semitic feeling in the world is inexcusable in the sight of God and man. I refer not here to the abominable cruelties of the obsessed German people. Behind that lies a history of Atlantean relationships into which it is needless for me to enter because I could not prove to you the truth of my statements. I refer to the history of the past 2,000 years into the everyday behavior of Gentile people everywhere. There must be a definite copyright 1998 Lewis's Trust. 159. A Treatise on the Seven Rays, Volume 4, Esoteric Healing. Effort upon the part of the nationals of every country to assimilate the Jews, to intermarry with them, and to refuse to recognize as barriers old habits of thought and ancient bad relations. Men everywhere must regard it as a blot upon their national integrity if there is the appearance within their borders of the old duality, Jew and Gentile. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, there is only humanity. This war 1914-1945 should be regarded as having brought to a conclusion the ancient enmity between Jew and Gentile, and the two groups have now the opportunity to originate a newer and happier measure of living and a truly cooperative relation on either side. The process of assimilation will be slow, for the situation is of so ancient a date that habits of thought, customary attitudes and separative customs are well established and hard to overcome. But the needed changes can be made if goodwill directs the spoken word, the written presentation and the mode of living together. The hierarchy sees no distinction. The head of the hierarchy, though not in a Jewish body at this time, achieved the highest spiritual goal for humanity whilst in a Jewish vehicle. The hierarchy is also sending into Jewish bodies certain disciples who will work with full intent at the changing of the situation. There are Jews today, a few in number, who do not think in terms of being Jews, who are not preoccupied with the Jewish problem to the exclusion of all else, and who are endeavoring to fuse all people into one humanity, thus bridging the gap. Again, I say, that the masters of the wisdom see neither Jew nor Gentile, but only souls and sons of God. In dealing with the subject of karma as a factor, decisive and lasting in both disease and health, one of the criticisms to which my approach is subjected is that I deal too much with generalities and that I give no specific and detailed analysis of particular diseases, particularly of the great basic diseases which today take such a toll of humanity and which are not fundamentally being curbed. I do not deal with their symptoms or their cure, and I indicate not techniques whereby they may be handled. This I feel is a criticism with which I should deal, so that you may proceed with your study under no misapprehension. This is an appropriate point at which to stop and meet this contention. Karma is necessarily a topic which is general and not specific. It is not yet accepted in the occult sense by the general public. It must be considered a long process. 160. The treatise on the seven rays, volume 4, esoteric healing. Essential that those of you who are interested in the study of disease and its healing should admit this and permit it to form the basis of your approach. I have indicated that medicine and medical treatments of the future will start with this fact as their prime determination. The factual nature of medical discovery is not disowned by me. I seek to carry the matter forward from that point, and it is no part of my program to ignore the wise discoveries of modern medical science, nor am I on the side of those groups of people who run down and refuse to admit the findings of modern medicine. This I have earlier emphasized. I want to indicate the trend of future medical research, which will be to seek for the seed of the trouble in the realm of vitality, as it may be called by orthodox investigators, and which we would regard as in the realm of the etheric body. Let me here make a practical statement which might be regarded as the next rule in this treatise. Rule 6. A careful diagnosis of the disease, based on the ascertained outer symptoms, will be simplified to this extent that, once the organ involved is known and thus isolated, the center in the etheric body which is in closest relation to it will be subjected to methods of occult healing. Healing, though the ordinary, ameliorative, medical or surgical methods will not be withheld. It is here that the fanatical cultist or healer of today so often goes astray. The old approach to medicine, with its physical investigation and its successful or unsuccessful diagnosis, will still be required until such time that physicians and surgeons have clairvoyant faculty, intuitive perception and spiritual insight, and also until they have worked out a technique for handling energy in relation to the patient. To this will someday be added correct astrological interpretation, immediate recognition of gray types, and then the application of the right healing techniques, as required by the ray which conditions the patient's life expression, plus his point in evolution. I am handicapped greatly as AI seek to lay the foundation for this new approach to medicine. I am handicapped by the idealistic pronouncements of the pioneers in the new fields of nature healing, by the naturopaths, and by the premises of Christian Science in the Unity schools. All that I can do, if you are to profit by my presentation, is to lay down certain broad and general assumptions which will govern the medical men of the future. But in the interim period between the old and the new eras, men will wander in a fog of speculation. A great conflict will be engineered between the fundamentalist schools and the speculators and the investigators of the new ideas, and temporarily that noble middle path of the Buddha will be forgotten. There is present today, in the science of medicine, a situation paralleling that to be found in the realm of religion. The old approach suffices for the masses and is frequently successful both in its ameliorative and preventive aspects, and in its process of diagnosis. This is all that is possible at this time. In the same manner, the old religious presentation suffices to guide the unthinking masses along certain broad lines of controlled living, and to keep clearly in the consciousness of copyright 1998 versus trust. 161. A treatise on the seven rays, volume 4, esoteric healing. The average man certain uncontrovertible spiritual facts. Both in the guidance and protection of the masses in their spiritual natures and in the guidance and protection inspection of their physical vehicles. Doctors and priests can be divided into various groups, some adhering to old approved techniques, some so fundamentalist in position that they refuse to investigate that which is new and unproven, and some so idealistic, speculative and fanatical that they rush ahead and enter into a world of speculative experiment which may or may not give them the key to the medicine of the future, but which certainly puts their patients into the category of what you call guinea pigs. The surest and least speculative field in medical practice is that which is concerned with the surgical relief of the patient. It is founded on a sure knowledge of anatomy. Its diagnosis of requirements can be intelligently controlled, and its practice, when in the hands of a sound and reputable surgeon, can and frequently does produce a cure or a real prolongation of life. However, even in that field, little is known about the results of an operation, as it may affect the etheric body and consequently the nervous system through the intermediate system of the nadis, or the etheric counterpart of the nerves. I would instance the removal of some organ. Definite results must necessarily be present, and a period of difficult adjustment must inevitably take place within the subtle mechanism of the patient. The area of the body which has received surgical treatment, and particularly the center in closest relation to it, must be affected, for the circulatory flow of energy emanating from the center will find itself short-circuited, if I could use such a phrase. This flow, which has hitherto passed through the area of surgical attention, must work its way to all parts of the body, via the nadis. These, as you know, underlie and feed the needed energy to the nervous system. Old channels for the flow of energy will have been removed, as the result of operative measures, major or minor. New channels are lines of force, bridging the mutilated area, will have to be established, and a basic adjustment will have to be made within the vital mechanism of the patient. Along this line, there is practically nothing as yet known. It is not even yet in the field of advanced research.